good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Madam Chair. Before I proceed with my presentation, I would like to acknowledge our Professor Van Beek. It is people like him that have inspired me up to today. For the past 15 years, I've been in ACO, attending as a student, and yeah, things are happening. And also people like Prof. Alvaro, Prof. Apollonia, and Prof. Now Crouch. I do appreciate your presence in our midst and just motivated me. All right, this is the work that was supposed to be presented by one of my master students, but for some reason, she could not manage to come. There are also some other issues that I'm not going to address during this presentation due to ethical issues and some of the results still work in progress, and I cannot divulge some of the information. So I'll go to the surface. In this province, so-called Eastern Cape, diabetes mellitus is a chronic metabolic disorder affecting many people, not only in Eastern Cape, not only in South Africa, worldwide. And the number of diabetics is also increasing. And in the near future, it may even double. Therefore, it becomes very important for us to search for alternatives. And I've had so many topics, so many talks on diabetes. Probably at some stage of the round table, we may need to discuss some of the issues and maybe go forward and work together in that regard. Because of that, it prompted us to carry out an ethnobotanical survey of these plants that are used for the management of diabetes in the OR Tambo region. Type 2 diabetes or adult onset diabetes is closely linked to lifestyle and is the most common type of diabetes. And the condition affects about 10% of the global population, and in South Africa, an estimated 1.8% of the population is living with diabetes. 1.8 may seem to be very small, but if the population is huge, that's a huge number of people that are affected. An estimated 60% of the South African population uses traditional medicine, and that includes plants and animals. Medicinal plants comprise a greater portion of these traditional medicines. It is thus important to record and get a database on the knowledge on these plants as they are possible future sources of novel alternative treatments. I know you scientists, you agree with me that it's not walking the path to get these drugs. There's a lot of work that has been invested, a lot of capital, a lot of discipline in ETC. This is where the study was carried out for a period of approximately 2 years, getting all the necessary information in as far as this grant is concerned. On methodology, fortunately, one of the researchers, one of my students, she comes from that area. So it was very easy, not very, it was relatively easy to get information. Because if I say very easy of lying, I don't want to be accused of lying. That's why I have used the word participatory appraisal, because she was part of the community, living with them, seeing how they do things, how they use plants, and so on. So it was workable. And that was collected from key informants. The key informants include traditional medical practitioners. We don't call them traditional healers anymore. It also included knowledgeable rural dwellers, those that live in the villages. That person may not be a traditional medical practitioner, but has got vast knowledge on the use of plants. So those people were consulted. And a total of 30 informants participated in this survey. If I say that it may look like, so in 30 days we die, it's not very easy to access them, get to know them, get their trust, be part of the big family. So I've kind of specialized in this area of extracting information from our people. It has been, I've been well trained to do that. I can safely say so, especially in the Eastern Cape province. I know that I don't want to use the word tricks, but I know the ways of getting information. All informants were requested to give verbal consent prior to participating in the summit, obviously for ethical reasons. And only willing informants were interviewed. When I say interviewed, it's not like going to Prof. Barber, just saying, Prof, I need 10 minutes of your time or 30 minutes of your time. The interview with one person can even take 2 months. Because it is in a series of stages. There are so many techniques that one has to apply, so much that you can get information. You may just go one day to just familiarize, just to know you. Second day, do you really know me? Third day, yeah, some kind of. And fourth day, you are getting there. After 1 month, probably, you are getting into the system. So the information, you will not get it in overnight. The questionnaire was administered through guided interviews and general conversations, as well as observations as well, in order to communicate effectively the local language was used. In this case, Isicos. And any other hidden information, subtle probing techniques were used to get maximal information. At times, scientists, we are not patient enough, especially students, because the student wants to graduate. So sometimes we take shortcuts, and at the end of the day, we don't get the right information. So students, be warned. Thank God I'm not only a student. Personal visits proved to be the most appropriate method. Probably you may need to take a bit of advice on this one. These visits, when you go, you don't just go as if you are walking into a toilet. No. You go there, you make an appointment. When you get there, you don't look too inquisitive. Looking around, your eyes are all over. You want to get information, I want to go. No. Go there with your plastic bag, so a few loaves of bread. You know, that's how we do it even when I'm going to my mother. I do the same thing. So it's not like it's different because it's a traditional healer. No, I treat them as elderly people, as parents. You go there, you meet them. You leave something and you go as if you don't want anything. But then the people of your mind, you know that. It's not that you're not treating them, that they're becoming part of the system so that you get to know what transpires or what happens. The survey that you would get information or wanted to get information such as the diagnosis of diabetes mellitus, local names of plants used. There's a challenge there. Prof. Ben Eric Van Rick will agree with me with the use of common names, how difficult it can be. Even in the same municipality or Baratambo region, it was difficult. It's a big region. One village, they can use another name, while another village, they use 2-3 names, name one plant. So the challenge is there. Local names of plants used, plant parts, methods of preparation, and also dosage, and the most common age treated with these medicinal plants. And obviously, from a scientific point of view, water specimens had to be prepared and deposited in the herbarium, obviously after proper identification of the plant in question. And the inventory of plants used for the management of diabetes mellitus was compiled. Now, on our results, that when it comes to diagnosis, it is largely based on their observation of clinical symptoms. So, okay, how do you know that this is diabetes? They will explain to you. Probably today they can say it in one version, then tomorrow it's another version. The third time you need to reconcile the first version and the second version and get to understand what they're talking about. These are some of the plus species that were commonly or consistently mentioned in most of the places that were visited. So on that basis, they were selected for further investigation. And this is the dry part. This is the distribution of methods used by respondents to diagnose diabetes. Some would say prevention, some will say hospital diagnosis, some will use symptomatic, some a combination of the first two, and so on. So this is the distribution. So most of it is as you can see, 73% is mostly on symptomatic. They'll just look at the symptoms. And some of the symptoms will include, for example, rapid weight loss, weakness, blurred vision, and they'll go to the extent of even checking the ends that normally visit your urine to see if there's no accumulation of sugars there, and slow healing wounds and polyuria. These are some of the symptoms that they will observe, and they say, we think, we suspect that you might be a diabetic patient. So diabetic mellitus can only be treated by a few traditional medical practitioners. From our survey, as we moved around, I mentioned 30 participants, but most of them, some of them, because we visited more than 30, but those ones that provided information were 30. Or some of them would say, move, we don't treat diabetes. So they were very honest enough to indicate to us. Indigenous knowledge on the premise that the symptoms is the disease, and not actually the cause. They may not focus more on the cause, but the focus may be on the symptom. Oh, this is just a list, a short list of the plants, but there are many. There's no way I can predict all of them. As you can see, the family name, the local name, the plant part used, as well as the preparation, you get all that information. The repeated citation of similar plant genera were mentioned, and the general consensus by respondents was that beta plant remedies are effective in the treatment of diabetes. Anything bitter, it is effective, according to them. But bitterness in plant is related probably to phenolic content, and phenolic and flavonoid compounds have been implicated as having various anti-diabetic properties. But bitter taste may arise from other phytochemicals such as alkaloids and tannins. Absence of phytochemicals such as phenols and flavonoids, however, does not rule out the use of plants as diabetic agents. This is the sequence of plant parts that are used. As you can see, the analogous part of the root was dominating. I'll be very quick because I'm about to my time. Underground plants, they dominated, but the findings here, it contrasts with other literature findings where the leaves are usually cited as the most frequently used potent plant parts. Now, let me go to conclusion. 1 minute, right? Thank you. The study has revealed 30 plant species used for the management of this disease. However, remedies must be taken with caution, since information on set of most plant species is scanty, or may be scanty. Documentation of important plant species such as medicinal plants is imperative, that this may be a source of novel plants. This work is still in progress, as we are still to, we have already done the cytotoxicity assays. Like I said earlier, there is information that I cannot divulge at this stage due to ethical issues and also the collaborators that are into play. I'd like to thank you and also thank NRF, as well as my university, and above all, to the participants that provided this information and what is still in progress. Thank you so much.